This episode is a tough one. This Sunday evening, found out, along with many others from the basketball community over here, the tragic death of the big brother, Kobe Bryant, alongside his daughter. A news that, man, like, it's just mad. Like, if you know me, I don't, you know, I don't do celebrities or anything like that. Many people who I've grew up with, whether it's musicians, any type of artist that I grew up on, have come and gone, and I, you know, felt some type of way, but nothing hit like this one. Never ever in my life has someone, as an athlete or any other public figure, passed away and had this effect in myself, in the basketball community, in the people that I've known. The way the news came in, it was just like, it's just something that I've never witnessed, something that I've never gone through before. And like many, I decided to share with you guys through my art, my experience with this great guy, and the effect a Kobe has had in my life, in other peers of mine, coaches, friends, and just how we just, you know, he's being, you know, touched all of us. If you don't know, I used to play basketball when I was younger. And Kobe was, you know, Kobe was like the number one, man. Like, it's just, I'm actually like struggling for words, because like just thinking about all them times growing up and talking about this guy and looking up to him and watching and emulating and reading upon him, and the things that I tried to emulate as a young player coming up, trying to be a professional basketball player. So before we start, my condolences to the Bryant family, to the Lakers organization, to everyone. My condolences to every single person on earth who Kobe Bryant touched, whether it's through his philosophy, hard work, or just his basketball craft. Kobe has always been, you know, a known player. I've pretty much known Kobe since he came in from college, from high school. And but my first memories of Kobe is when I first bought a jersey. There's a little story to this, so let me get into that. So you know, when I moved to London from Lisbon, I had only played basketball in school level, like secondary school level. And, you know, 3 years in, I went to a basketball camp. Me and Joe went to a basketball camp, actually. Joe was part of that basketball camp, and I think that's when we really started to hang out, was after that summer. You know, prior to that, we only really messed around, like, you know, playing basketball in school, but we didn't hang out or anything like that. So after that summer, just kicking it together, going to this new club that we didn't, you know, pretty much know anyone besides just me and him and some other guy. And, you know, by the end of summer camp, we get recruited to the team. And now I need basketball gear, you know. So I think we did a week of camp. The coach liked us, wanted us back. now I need some gear, because you know, now you know we're gonna get into stuff like, you know, preparing for season, getting to know players and stuff like that. And the first thing I tell my mom is like, yo, I need, because I already had shorts, I need a jersey. Now, I don't know how this happened, but I managed to finesse my mom in getting this jersey, right? So we go off to the high street, hit the shops. There's a bunch of stores, and you know, your typical African parents always trying to get you the cheaper stuff. And this jersey, which actually I'm wearing at the beginning of this video, I bought the biggest size I could, so I could have the longest, and please believe, till this day, it still fits me. I don't know how. And yeah, man, and it was like, I gotta get Kobe, you know, I gotta get number 8. And I pretty much practice with that jersey every day, man. Like, sweat, come home, wash it, put it out to dry in the garden, you know, next day is nice and dry, off to practice again. So that was pretty much my first real interaction with this guy. And if you ask me, the reason why I wanted to pick Kobe is because of all the videos I'd seen, he was the guy at the time that was more relevant, you know. So I grew up watching Michael, but I played during Kobe, you know. So that's how I see the way I got involved with basketball, and the way I see it with players of the generations. So yeah, man. So that was my first real interaction, you know, getting his jersey and just balling out. And now that I have his jersey, now I'm starting to looking at, you know, more and more into videos. At the time, it was really hard to get, and I would only get, like, you know, a bunch of mixtapes of my godfather. So like a lot of the And Ones and stuff, and some of them Kobe was in it. Now, this is before the YouTube era. You see, back then you would only find like websites with basketball video clips, and you'd go there and you watch it. Fast forward, now we're growing up, now we're into season, and you know, like, I'm pretty sure like every other team, when you're on the road, you're talking about basketball and, you know, the games that happen on that week and the plays and the dunks. And Kobe was always in the topic, man. He was always in the mix. I remember one particular time I showed a couple of my friends this Kobe dunk. Now, I till this day, I don't know if this is like, you know, like a stunt or something, but Kobe gets a steal and he goes on the fast break and he does like a 360 in the air while moving the ball around his waist, and he dunks it. And that dunk stayed in my mind forever, man. Like, at that time I was like, this is the best dunk I've ever seen, man. Best dunk. So those are the, you know, a lot of the memories I get when talking about Kobe and thinking about, you know, those times. And who, you know, at the time he was, you know, he was T-Mac. It was pretty much T-Mac and Kobe were the main guys. You know, you also had Allen Iverson. And as much as we love Iverson, we were tall kids, so Iverson was like the point guards, the little point guards' favorite player. Well, because Kobe was taller, like, we would look at Kobe and T-Mac. I think at the age of 15, 16, we got into, we got hang of the Air Alert program. For those who don't know, Air Alert was a jumping program. Like, I think it was like 8 weeks program where you do it every day and it would improve your vertical. Now, me as a non super athletic kid, especially amongst my peers, that's something I wanted to do. You know, I wanted to jump high because, you know, I wanted to dunk the ball. I mean, I see Kobe dunking, I see T-Mac dunking, I see Vince Carter dunking. You know, these are the guys at the time, we like showreels, man. And being one of the best players in my school, like, that was, I feel that was the only factor I needed. So, you know, we jump on this air alert because now I want to dunk the ball like Kobe. And I do, I think, I'm pretty sure I ran through this program like 2-3 times. I've done the whole program. And although my vertical did increase, it didn't increase as much. So I get to one point and I'm like, ah, like, you know, forget this. I'm a focus more on basketball. And, you know, maybe as I grow up, I you know, my vertical improves. Fast forward now, my under 18s year, I come across, I think it was like an article or a picture or something. Kobe is wearing like a, I don't know if I can't even remember if he was wearing a tutu or something, but Kobe was doing ballet, right? And when we saw that, we kind of like all laughed. And he was like, you know, why is Kobe like wearing the, you know, doing ballet and stuff like that? And to us, especially in our community, black community, like, you never see like a black man doing ballet, you know. To us, that was news. Although my mom did do ballet, and I've got pictures of her when she was younger doing ballet, like, I never showed interest, so, and I never seen, you know, a black man doing that. But me, being me, very intrigued kid, I wanted to find out why he was doing that, you know. And it turns out he was doing that because he kind of like helped with his flexibility, explosiveness, and, you know, muscle wise. And it clicked. I was like, oh, maybe I need to do that because I struggle to jump, you know. And but then I'm like, ah, there's no way I'm gonna do ballet, you know. Somehow, I can't remember properly, but I end up doing yoga at the back of that, you know, back of Kobe doing ballet. I'm going to do yoga. I can't remember if he was doing yoga as well. These guys, these are just, you know, fragments, memories that I have of this guy growing up. And now, I think it's like towards the end of my season, you know, I head off to Nighttown, trying to get, you know, this yoga mat. There is no yoga, there's only one yoga mat, and it's a pink one. And I'm just like, I am so determined to get into this class. I'm like, all right, cool, I'll buy it. By the way, the girl that's serving me, she's like, are you sure you want to get this? Because, you know, it's kind of feminine. I'm like, don't worry about it. You know, I swallow my pride. I get the mat, the pinkest mat you can think of, that's the mat I got. And I head over to the yoga class. Bear in mind, this is before yoga was trending. This is before everybody turned into a yogi and the hot yogas, and it was a trend, and the hot, the coffee shops, all of that. This is before that, right? So I'm really excited, because I'm like, yo, this is my next step and everything. I get to the class, boom. I show up and I'm the only dude, you know, 6'4". I think by that time I was 6'5", 6'4", 6'5". I walk in with the pinkest mat and every single woman is looking at me. And I'm just like, I am so embarrassed, but there was that thing, that Kobe thing, that kind of like every kid wanted to do, is just like, just do it, like, just get on with it, you know, just make that work for you, because you need to be the greatest, you need to be the baddest on the court. So again, swallow my pride, I walk in, I am embarrassed as hell, man. Like, it wasn't cool, you know, especially I'm a teenager, it wasn't cool. But anyway, I'm focused, you know, I'm trying to be the best I can be. I go in, man. I go in, and now the weeks go by and I'm starting to feel really good, man. Like, really good. I've never felt like my body before. And I'm just like, this Kobe stuff really works. You know? At this particular time, I'm taking like a gap year. I don't go straight to uni. I'm taking a gap year to go to the States. But I'm working on my game. So for a whole year, I'm working on my game. And I'm starting to read books because I've seen that this thing works, you know? And that just opened up my eyes a little bit more to what this guy was on, you know? I didn't fully comprehend. I was just trying to copy the guy. I was just trying to get the bunnies like he had the bunnies, you know? So I'm starting to read books. Right, who's the next person I can, you know, Kobe doesn't have no books, you know? So the closest person I can get is Phil Jackson. So here comes the Phil Jackson books, you know? Start reading Phil Jackson book, and in there's a particular passage in Phil Jackson's book where when Kobe was a rookie, when he first came into the league at the first practice, if I'm not mistaken, Kobe challenges, I think, the best player in the team at the time. I can't remember. Guys, if you know, jump in the comment section below and let me know. But then, all right, cool. He challenged the next guy. Next guy accepts it. Kobe busts open this guy, like, wide open. And that sort of mentality put me on some next stuff, because I've always been like a quiet guy on the court, right? But I always kind of let my game talk for itself. But from that point, I was like, it kind of gave me an edge to be a bit more comfortable with myself, a bit like trying to explore, trying to push that barrier, you know, challenge. And the thing is, it was nothing new to me, because as younger kids, we always played against olders, right? But I always kind of like kept my mouth shut, and I would just ball out. You know, these older dudes used to come to the park and challenge us, and we'd bust them wide open, but I would never say anything. I kind of like to stay in my corner. So when I'm starting to read these things, and then I'm preying the way this guy is, and this is not even through him, this is through Phil Jackson's words, I'm just like, this dude is something else, you know? And through that, Now my eyes start to open, you know. I'm starting to have conversations with coaches. One particular conversation I can share with you guys is that because my coach was so aware of me reading books and going into this, shout out to Coach Junior Williams. One day I walk into practice. It's actually after practice. You know, we used to do this thing that we used to get donuts. So I pull out the bag after practice to eat my donut, and my coach is looking at me like, yo, what are you doing? And I'm baffled, because I'm just like, I'm just eating my donut, man. I just had practice. I'm hungry, you know? Like, I'm, you know, skinny guy, fast metabolism. I got to eat something. And coach goes, oh, man, you know, if you want to take this serious, not only do you have to practice like a professional, but you got to eat like a professional. And I was just like, I'm just looking at this guy, and there is two ways this can go. I can be like, yeah, coach, and in my head I'm telling him, shut the like, I'm gonna do my own thing, or I'm gonna listen to you and take that openness, that eagerness of just learning and being an open book. So I'm just like, cool, coach. This is one of the things that, looking back and studying Kobe, and whenever you'd hear him talk, or I would find pieces of information about this guy, how he studied the game, how he always asked questions, he always went about certain ways to get himself better. That's what got stuck with me. And not only just on a basketball court. One thing I can easily share with you guys is one of the reasons why I got interested in investing, because through this guy, And I don't even think I was aware of it at the time. But because he was so open to learn, so open to a lot more things instead of just basketball, that I wanted to be like that. I wanted to be in that frame of mind. So now, as a young guy, I'm like, okay, these are the things I don't have in life. How can I move forward? So, you know, so when I was doing little things that must have been a bit awkward to my peers, like looking into the finance and then trading and all sorts of, I think I traded for like 3 years, you know. But these are things I would never get from my parents. These are things I would never get from like my family. But through these guys, you know, Kobe's ways, and not just Kobe, but everyone that was around Kobe, you know, reading all these books helped me out, not just as a basketball player, but as a young man, understanding the ways of the world and how I could improve my life. Man, there's just so many conversations we had about this guy, so many arguments we used to have involving Kobe. One of the main ones was the Kobe Jordan argument. Who was better than who? And my argument was like, Kobe's better than Jordan because he's the next thing, you know. Like if you look at Kobe, and I grew up watching Jordan, so to me, when someone was coming with the argument of Jordan being better, I'm like, Kobe is Jordan 2.0, you know, without the hang time. But to me, Kobe was always that guy, man. I can honestly say that he not did he just influence me, but he influenced my peers, whether they were my team or my rivals, you know, other teams. Because now it's like you got these kids who you go play against, looking at Kobe, trying to emulate Kobe, practicing on the side, you know, and on the weekend when you go to meet them, they're trying to bust you up. So not only Kobe made them better, but by making them better, I had to get better to be able to compete with those guys. So, you know, so it's not just me. Kobe affected me. He affected my teammates, people I played against, and not, you know, at the time, a few years down the line. And, you know, that's the legacy left, man. That's a bunch of competitive kids. You know, I can speak for London because, you know, UK, pretty much the UK, when, you know, whether we go to Manchester or Birmingham, you know, or whether I would go down Brixton to play against those boys. That was, you know, that was the fight, man. That weekend fight we was always looking forward to, you know, and that made us aggressive on and off the court, man. That made us competitive. That made us competitive young guys, you know, coming up in places that there wasn't really much for us. So when you have someone like Kobe day in, day out competing, being in highlights, I think they used to be the top 10 back then, and we'd be eager to sit down and watch the top 10 and then go and try to emulate those moves, man. Last but not least, and if you're wondering why I'm playing Bruce Lee Game of Death throughout this whole video, is because I always felt Kobe Bryant was the Bruce Lee in the league. There was always about something about questions with this guy, and to my knowledge and me reading Bruce Lee books, Bruce Lee also had books. So that was another thing that drew me into Kobe, because I was like, this dude is like Bruce Lee, like mind over matter, and you know, being the next thing, because Bruce Lee never settled for what was then. He was always in the moment, you know. So that's that, man. And With that said, I mean, there's so much more to say, but we're gonna stay for here, and that is my story, that is my upbringing, that is my experience with the one and only Kobe Bryant. Rest in peace, fam. And I hope you're just, in a better place with your daughter. Mamba out. Kobe!